Hello, everybody. I want to talk about computers. And when I mean computers, of course, I mean devices like this one, right? A device which you probably have in your offices, doing your mail, doing your work, or devices you have maybe back home, surfing into the internet, playing computer games. But computers are also things like that one here. The smartphone, which most likely most of you have in your pocket right now, hopefully put on silent right now. But frankly speaking, computers are actually everywhere. For example, in cars, we have nowadays hundreds of computers in cars today. Computers who control our brakes, who make sure that we're not crashing into other cars, who make sure that we stay in lane. And actually, more than that, we have computers basically everywhere in our daily life. We have them in trams, we have them in trains, in aircrafts, even in things like washing machines and coffee machines, right? Think about it. I mean, how is it possible that when you push one button in a coffee machine, you get a latte macchiato, and if you push another button, you get a cappuccino? This is only because there's a tiny, small computer inside your coffee machine, which makes sure that you get what you wanted. And basically, this whole thing is so impressive. Well, actually, this is what I wanted to show. We have them everywhere. And basically, this alone is a very interesting story by itself. But you know what is even more fascinating than that? That all these computers, which are literally running the world today, all these computers are based on electronic systems which work basically with nothing else but with power off and power on. That means all these computers basically work just with what we computer scientists say with zero and with one. And this, in my opinion, is really fascinating. How is it possible that computers who run the world basically boil down to something simple as zero and one? So another question, how is it possible how the world runs with zero and one? And that's what I want to illustrate in this talk here, okay? And to do that, let's get back to school. This is an electronic circuit, right? Probably many of you have seen that in school, right? That's basic stuff. A very simple electronic circuit. We've got two switches as kind of input of our system, and we got one light as kind of output of our system. And to formalize that, I mean, I'm a computer scientist, so be prepared, this is going to be a lot of math today here. So to formalize that, let's give them names. So let's say the first switch is called A, the second switch is called B, and the light is called C, right? And now let's keep formalizing. When we say this first switch is open, we computer scientists say, well, okay, A is assigned zero. When the switch is closed, we say A is assigned, one. We do the same with B. If B is open, B is zero. If B is closed, it is one. And a similar thing is done with the light as well. If the light is off, we call it zero. If the light is on, we call it C is assigned to one. Okay? And this is a very simple electronic system. And in fact, this system allows us to conduct four possible computations. More precisely, if we have zero and zero, that means if you have both of the switches open, what is the light doing? Well, the light is off, right? So the output will be zero. The same if, for example, the first switch is open, the second switch is closed, what is the light going to be? Zero. And in the other case as well, only when both switches are set, are closed, that means both inputs are assigned one, then the light will go on as well, and that's the only output where we get a one, okay? So far, so clear. And this already is a computer, right? A very trivial electronic circuit already constituting a computer, computing or calculating what we call an AND function. The light only is put on if both of the switches are closed, okay? And now, I hope you believe me when I say, okay, we can, of course, build many of these kind of trivial circuits, right? For example, here's another electronic circuit. Again, we've got a couple of switches, we've got an output. And now this electronic circuit just computes something different, namely a function defined like that. Very similar, but here now we got always the light on when exactly one of the switches is turned on. And the light will go off in all the other cases. And we call this an exclusive OR function. And, well, those functions, those electronic circuits, everybody can build that back at home. It's basically no problems. Those form computers. And now you may ask, okay, well, but we expect that computers like your smartphones, you talked before, right, or the computers back home, computers who actually do real things, not this stupid thing like an AND function nobody needs, right? But so in order to do that, let's think about what a computer is again. A computer is actually nothing else but a sequence of operations, a sequence of calculations to be conducted on an electronic circuit. That means when you surf in the internet, when you play your computer games, you're basically not doing nothing else but execute a sequence of additions, multiplications, subtractions operations, maybe even a little bit more sophisticated stuff like taking an integral or maybe doing a matrix multiplication. But overall, you basically do something like arithmetic. Still, this has nothing to do with an end function, maybe? Well, let me show. Let's talk about something like addition. Let's talk about a little bit more complex functionality. Let's do a little bit addition. And we start simple. What is 0 plus 0? It's 0. What is 0 plus 1? 1. 1 plus 0 is 1 as well. And now I'm interested, what is 1 plus 1? Okay, we say 2, okay? Although probably some people in the room would disagree for now, but of course we come back to that in a moment. So this is basically an addition, a very simple addition operation, and this is one part what should be executed on a computer. Now we've got a problem, because the title of this talk is How the World is Won by 0 and 1. We've got the 2 here right now. So we have a finite number of characters we can use in order to conduct our operation. And this could be a problem, right? But actually it's not, because we have the same problem as human beings as well. When we do math, when we add two numbers, we are also restricted in the characters we can use, because we basically only have numbers from 0 to 9. Right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Then we're running out of numbers, so we start over again with 0, but we just put another carry in front of it. We say after 9 comes 0, and we put a 1 in front of that, so we've got 10. And then we continue, 11, 12, 13, blah, 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 until 19. Then we're running out of characters again, and then we're doing the same thing again. We're making the same thing here as well. We're running out of characters. Well, okay, no problem. We simply use a 0 here, and we put one more value in front of it, and that's it. So we count 0, 1, 10, 11, 100, and so on and so forth. And if I have a carry for this particular case, of course, I need a carry for the other cases as well. And then this is my definition of an adder function, of a very simple adder function, right? And now comes the fun part. We already realized that. Because this guy here is the first electronic circuit I showed you at the very beginning, the end function. This guy here, we can also very easily realize this was the second electronic circuit I showed you at the beginning. So we can build a computer by just putting puzzle pieces together, namely the end function, which we represent in the following by what we call a gate, something like that, and the XOR function, which we now call an XOR gate. And we simply have to put the corresponding inputs together. And then we simply define, OK, you know what? Whatever is the output, or whatever the light shows at the end output, this is going to be our carry. And whatever the light shows at the XOR output, this is going to be our sum. And then we've got our computer, which is capable of adding 1 plus 1. Everybody can do that, right? Now you say, OK, but 1 plus 1 is a really tiny kind of computer. What about something like adding 1024 with 950 larger numbers? What do you do then? Well, the same principle applies. You do more of the same. You probably need a little bit more switches, a little bit more inputs, a little bit more output, obviously. But overall, the concepts don't change. You just need a little bit more gates. Right? And then comes the question, but what with subtraction? What with multiplication, with division, with all the other things I talked about, matrix multiplication, all this thing you need to eventually conduct your, I don't know, web search or your computer game? The same principle applies. You just need a little bit more gates, right? And putting these puzzle pieces together, starting with these trivial electronic circuits I showed you at the very beginning, basically gets something like you end up with maybe a large electronic circuit. It may actually amount to up to 1 billion gate. But eventually, this composition of puzzle pieces will eventually lead to something what is your computer today. What is in your pockets, what is back in your office, what is in your cars, in your aircraft, and so on and so forth. That's basically the essence of how a computer works. All right? So where's the problem? Computers are easy, but where's the problem? Well,
the sheer amount of gates you have to control is a problem. We talk about 1 billion, up to 1 billion puzzle pieces which need to be plugged together. Did you ever solve the puzzle composed of 100 pieces? How long did it take you? How long do you need to solve a puzzle composed of 1,000 pieces? How long do you need to complete the puzzle composed of 5,000 pieces? I know for sure I need days for that, if I even have the stamina good to go through. Usually I start these kind of things and then just give up because it's getting boring after a while. Here we're talking about a puzzle composed of up to 1 billion pieces. And frankly spoken, no human being can do this manually anymore. That is, as strange as it sounds, that is why we need computers, well, to build computers. This is a complexity we only can handle with computers. And even worse, it doesn't stop with that. Just solving a puzzle piece of 1 billion gates is not the end of the story, because, as we said before, we are putting these computers everywhere today. They are on our aircrafts, for example. And if you do an electronic system composed of 1 billion gates, up to 1 billion gates, into an aircraft, you better make sure that this thing actually always behaves as you intended to behave, because you don't want to be on an aircraft asking, well, suddenly some unexpected scenario occurs, I actually don't know for sure how my computer will react on that, right? You don't want, I mean, I don't want it. I mean, if you like, go ahead, but I don't want that. So we have to think about, okay, how many possibilities do I have to check in order to make sure that my computer always behaves as intended? And then we have to talk about another thing of complexity. Let's get back to the basics again. If I have a computer with two inputs, well, then the number of scenarios I have to check is actually quite moderate. We had that before. It is a total of, here we go, it is a total of 4 different cases, right? If we have a computer with 3 inputs, the number of scenarios I have to consider double again, because we have 8 cases again. If I have a computer with 4 inputs, you see where this is going, then I have 16 cases. With 5 inputs, I have 32 cases. So there's I double the number of scenarios, the number of cases with each input I add. And now you can think about, well, how many inputs does a computer usually have? I mean, hopefully everybody in the room will agree that most of our computers are not composed of 5 inputs. We hardly were able to do an adder and 1 plus 1 just with 2 inputs. We certainly need more for larger operations. So we most likely have circuits which are composed of hundreds of inputs. Well, and how many possibilities do you have here? Well, you have 2 to the power of 300 cases, which translated is something like 10 to the power of 90 cases. Think about that. This is a 1 with 90 zeros. I'm not sure if this most likely we have a name for that, but I don't know. But I mean, you know what? You probably can imagine what a million is, what a billion is, maybe a trillion, and then we're already losing our mind about the quantity of these kind of numbers. We're talking about something with, I don't know, 1 with 90 numbers. It's incredibly hard. So let's put things into perspective. What does it mean? And for this, I would like to provide you with another number. I keep asking myself how they came up with these numbers, but I don't know. The internet says that's the number, so the internet is always 2, so that's the number. Physicists have found out that the number of the atoms in the universe is something like 10 to the power of 78. Just let's believe for a moment that this is a correct number. Then that means you are faster quickly counting the number of the atoms in the universe rather than checking all possibilities for a circuit with just 300 inputs. Right? Talking about complexity. And this is basically the bottom line what I wanted to show. So what is the take-home message? First, building computers is totally easy. I showed you the electronic circuits at the beginning, right? This is all you need to know in order to build a computer. You just need to puzzle it together, then you're done. Building computers is totally easy. Second, building computers is totally hard. It is incredibly complex. Not only do you have to solve a puzzle composed of 1 billion pieces, once you're done with that, you have to solve a task which is actually harder than counting the number of the atoms in the universe. That's my message. Thank you very much.